Tonight we are in the mountains of western Colombia, and we are looking for Heterophrynus silviae. This is a species of large tailless whip scorpion, and they live mostly along rivers and streams. Here on this dirt embankment, where the river becomes quite narrow, we have our first Heterophrynus silviae. This one right here. This one is a large female. This is the largest species of amblypygid, or tailless whip scorpion, that lives out here. But that isn't saying all that much, because there's only one other species of amblypygid that lives out here. That one is in the genus Paraphrynus. Paraphrynus is a genus that has showed up on this channel quite a few times, and since this is Heterophrynus' first appearance on this channel, I'm going to show you the difference between the two. I actually brought a Paraphrynus with me to show you them side by side, and I'm going to relocate the tree I found it on later to release it. Looking at these side by side, the difference is quite obvious. The pedipalp shape between the two is completely different. On Heterophrynus, as you can see, the arms are quite long and there's a concave tibial curve. These two species also partition the forest a little bit. The Heterophrynus are far more prevalent next to the river. Meanwhile, the Paraphrynus tends to dominate the forest. There's quite a noticeable exception to this general rule, however. Along streams that are more disturbed, Paraphrynus tend to replace the Heterophrynus. The Heterophrynus seem to be much less resilient. They're also more evenly spaced out, whereas Paraphrynus often creates clusters. And this is one of very few species of Heterophrynus that is found west of the Andes. What I'm holding here is known as the big claw river shrimp, Macrobrachium carcinus, and this might be the largest freshwater prawn by mass in all of Colombia. I have seen hundreds of these at this point, but I decided to show you this one because it's the largest that I've seen as of yet. I did catch one about half this size earlier. It managed to pinch me and actually drew blood, so that is why I'm holding this one the way that I am. And these are also capable of autotomy, which is another reason that it's a good idea to hold them like I am right now. The other night I was able to observe these river prawns feeding on a large oreid centipede. That is a family of giant soil centipedes, and it was both this species and Macrobrachium hancocki that were feeding on it. Macrobrachium hancocki is the blue one. I have two Ctenophryne aterrima that I found nearby in a large rotten log, and these really are some peculiar frogs. They're commonly known as black narrowmouth frogs, and they were first described in 1901. They're found in Costa Rica, Panama, western Colombia, and western Ecuador, and they're quite rarely encountered. But even though these are very rarely seen, they are still listed as least concern by IUCN. One of the reasons that they're so rare is because they spend much of their time in the ground. Compared to all the frogs that are found out here, this one is the most fossorial. These can be hidden nearly a meter down in the ground, and they typically come to the surface on rainy nights. The way this frog feeds is by sitting in front of a trail of ants or termites and picks them off one by one as they walk by. I think this is part of the reason that they were living in the log I found them in. This log contains quite a few termites and trapjaw ants. Compared to most, the two individuals that we have right here are quite light in color. These are usually much darker. And of course, the most important aspect of their morphology, they are quite squishy, as you can tell. When you push one side in, the other one grows, as you can see here. We have a Rhinobothryum bovallii in this dead branch here. For obvious reasons, this snake is commonly referred to as the false tree coral snake, and for me, this is quite a puzzling adaptation. Coral snakes are overwhelmingly terrestrial and even fossorial. Meanwhile, this false tree coral is predominantly arboreal, so I'm not really sure which predator is getting fooled by this. That being said, I'm sure this mimicry works quite well on humans. This is one of only two species of Rhinobothryum. The other one is Rhinobothryum lentiginosum. That one is found on the Amazon side, meanwhile this one is found in the Andes, or to the west and north of that range. Specifically, it's found in Honduras, Nicaragua, Costa Rica, Panama, western Venezuela, northwestern Colombia, and western Ecuador. Though the species does have an extensive distribution, it seems to be generally unreliable to find. This is one of the largest semi-arboreal to arboreal snake species that can be found in Colombia. These mainly feed on lizards, something for which their venom is specialized, but they also feed on birds and rodents. When these are disturbed, they might bite, but they also shake the tip of their tail on the ground. There's a speedy little juvenile Heterophrynus down here that I will attempt to catch. Adult Heterophrynus and other tailless whip scorpions can have great bursts of speed, but as it tends to be across the entire order, these juveniles are even speedier, or at least relative to their body size. And the one that we have here is likely a couple molts in. It could be about a year old or so, at least from the time that it left its mother's back. Due to the microhabitat preference that these have, that being holes in dirt embankments next to rivers, the species does not have a fixed gestation or mating period. The climate inside the holes that they live in is likely extremely constant, which allows for this kind of reproductive cycle. At this point, I have seen a couple adult females with egg sacs. Females with egg sacs can still be seen out at night because they're still feeding, but as soon as the eggs hatch, they rarely venture out as long as the babies are still on their back. Down here in the stream, we have an Echinosaura palmeri, this lizard right here. This lizard that we have here is commonly known as Palmer's hedgehog lizard, and the entire genus is known as hedgehog lizards. The name Echinosaura is Greek. It can be broken down into two words, echinos and sora. Echinos means hedgehog in Greek, and sora means lizard, so it translates directly to the common name. These lizards get that name for quite an obvious reason. They are, as you can tell, quite spiny. They have a few columns of these spines on their dorsum, and a couple of them are more pronounced than the others. These spines are more pronounced on the males than the females. Another way that you can distinguish males is they have a wider or broader head than the females do. This is a species that is both diurnal and nocturnal, and the areas you can see them most reliably are ones with many tree roots as well as rocks that are adjacent to a stream or a river. This is a semi-aquatic species that can actually swim quite fast, even against the current. We have a Sachatamia ilex here on this leaf above the stream. This frog is commonly known as the ghost glass frog, and it's found in Costa Rica, Panama, Western Colombia, and Western Ecuador. And over this relatively large distribution, they don't exhibit much variation. Of course, we are on a river right now, and that is where Sachatamia ilex likes to hang out, like the majority of other glass frogs. At night, they can be quite low next to the stream, but during the day, they move upwards. As I'm recording this, it is late May, which means that for this population of these frogs, mating season has just begun, and we can hear a lot of the males calling around this time. Unsurprisingly, this frog is quite well known for its eyes. You can see that they're tessellated white and dark gray, and this is not something that you see in many other frog species. In fact, around here, it's almost diagnostic. There's only one other frog species with similar eyes, and that is Tarantula spinosa, which around here is a much rarer species. Sachatamia ilex, however, is considered to be the most common species of glass frog around here. There is an Oxyrhopus petolarius moving through the leaf litter down here. That is this snake. This snake is commonly referred to as the forest flame snake in English, but unsurprisingly, in both Portuguese and Spanish, this is yet another species of false coral snake. The one that we have here is a juvenile, and it looks quite a bit different from the adult snake. You'll notice that the color of the lighter bands shifts as you move to the posterior end of this snake. On top of that, the coloration of some of these bands is incomplete, some being half white and half orange. Neither of these two things that I just mentioned are present in the adult snakes. All of the bands that you see here that are white or orange will turn into a uniform rusty red color. This is one of the most widespread neotropical snake species. It's found in southern Mexico, all of the Central American countries, but not confirmed from El Salvador, and over much of South America. Throughout this distribution, the elevation range that they occupy is quite striking. They are found at sea level, all the way up to 3,000 meters in the Andes. With such a large distribution, you may be wondering, where was the species described from? And the answer is that the type is from Africa. This snake was described by Carl Linnaeus in 1758, and I'm sure he could have gotten the home continent of this species correct if he had just gone to collect it himself. Last couple things about this species. It is primarily nocturnal, but sometimes encountered during the day as well, and it has quite a generalist diet, feeding on various reptiles, amphibians, birds, and mammals. We have our third and our fourth Heterophrynus silviae on this rock wall right here. The first one is over here, and the second one is hidden away a little bit. It's up there. Wow, that hurts. Oops. I think the larger of these two Heterophrynus silviae is gravid. I'm referring to the one that doesn't look like it's been rained on. And it isn't a coincidence that this one is an adult female. Actually, all three of the adults that we've seen tonight were females.
Hold on, we've been interrupted by some kind of rodent here.
All right, I don't know what the hell that was, but back to our regularly scheduled program. Because these Heterophrynus are so large, they are able to feed on lizards and frogs. And I did get the chance to observe this once while out here. The Heterophrynus in question was not even a full-grown adult, but it had still managed to snatch a frog for itself, and was quite likely unable to finish the whole thing. These might end up feeding on frogs more often than lizards due to their proximity to running water. Unlike the tailless whip scorpions I've dealt with in the past, these ones have much longer spines and are more powerful, so when I get spiked, it does actually cause some pain.
Down here on this plant, we have a small tarantula, and I believe this one is in the genus Neischnocolus. Chances are this one's going to be quite flighty. Let's see.
Along with a recently described tarantula species that lives around here, Neischnocolus mecana, there's a third tarantula out here in addition to this one that I'm also calling Neischnocolus. That is an extremely shaky ID. I don't even know why I'm calling it that, but it's a placeholder for the time being. This one, however, that we are looking at, I am almost positive is in the genus Neischnocolus. And it seems that when comparing to Neischnocolus mecana, this one appears to have the same biology. One aspect of this is they're always found in the same places. Both of them are most frequently encountered on low vegetation, as well as in rotting logs. Unlike Neischnocolus mecana though, I've not yet seen one of these in a burrow, and appears in the forest 1/5 as often. And also unlike Neischnocolus mecana, I have yet to see an adult of one of these. Well, that will be all for this video of looking for Heterophrynus silviae in Colombia. Hope you enjoyed, and thank you for watching.